The question is another third key, and they are different. And so these keys are pre-generated, related to each other. And so then if a public key is fixed and the secret key is also fixed. Okay, so then the ciphertext encrypted by using a public key is only decrypted by a secret key which is related to co-generated with a public key. Okay? And the concept of functional encryption is more some kind of advanced and sophisticated, and then there are some provide freedom in a relation of encryption and decryption. So then we introduce additional parameter, phi. And so encryption is executed with using the public key and a parameter. And the ciphertext can be decrypted by a secret key with parameter psi, another parameter. So then phi is used in encryption, and psi is embedded in a secret key. Okay? And when the ciphertext is decrypted, so if some logical relation between phi and psi holds, then if and only if, then the decryption is decrypted. So this is a concept of functional encryption. It's a very general concept, and if we set parameter phi and psi empty string, then it is just a public encryption. And if we set a relation R as equality, maybe equality is a most simple vertical relation, then it is just identity-based encryption. So IDE is a very, very special case of functional encryption. And also public encryption is also a very, very special case of functional encryption. And this is this table shows previously proposed functional encryptions. So the most typical, simplest one, IDBase encryption is here. They are called identity. And ABE, attribute-based encryption, often use attribute and access structure. And attribute are used for in a part of the encryption, and access structure is used as a decryption key. Then we often call access structure a policy. So then in the case is a key includes a policy, so then key policy. And if access structure then used as a part of a ciphertext, then the policy is embedded in a ciphertext. Is a ciphertext policy AB. So, and the condition R is access structure accept attributes. Okay, and also another type of functional encryption, inner product encryption. In the case, a parameter for encryption is a vector of FQ or ZN, FQ or some ring, and psi is also vector. V vector, and then the condition of decryption is they are orthogonal or inner product is zero. Okay, so there are a list of the existing functional encryption. Okay, and access structures are in general by a spam program and. And in a product relation includes CNF and DNF formulas. So this in a product also covers a fairly general relation. But this also more general. This includes a threshold and sometimes NAT gate is included. Okay, so what is the application of a functional encryption? For example, in a ciphertext policy ABE, firstly, authority generates a public key and secret key, and the public key is a system parameter, so anyone can get a public key. And secret key is issued for each user. For example, in the case is the authority is gives attribute of a user. So then, for example, her key is parameterized by the affiliation and the university A and the math department and the position of the professor, etc. And then she got such a key. And he puts encrypted data on some public site or some cloud computing. Okay, anyway, so then this text is encrypted by using a parameter of access structure. So then the ciphertext parameterized by who can decrypt the some policy. Policy is a parameter of the ciphertext, and this is also some policy, the policy. And then, so then this attribute satisfies this policy, then she can decrypt this and we get this document. But the policy and satisfies this attribute, then she cannot decrypt this document. Okay? This is a typical ciphertext policy. So ciphertext are parameterized by the some access structure policy. And other applications are key policy. So then similarly, after a public key and master secret key are generated by the authority and public key and system parameter. And so in this case, user got a secret key with a policy. So then the policy means so the secret key has some parameterized some capability which document can be decrypted by this key. So then its policy is parameterized. And the some contents are put in a place, and each content are encrypted by attributes. So then this is this content is a animation, and price is $10, and it's a content dorama $20, and members only, or education content software $15, etc. And this policy, this key, satisfies this attribute, then by using key, she can get this content, but she cannot decrypt these contents. Okay, this is an example of application of KPABE. Okay, so then functional encryption is expressed by the four algorithms, setup, that means in the application example, authority uses this algorithm to generate a pair of system parameter, system public key, and master secret key. And keygen algorithm also used by authority to issue a secret key for each user. So then this secret key is parameterized by the this secret key parameterized by psi, and this is phi is a parameter for encryption, and ciphertext is parameter by the phi, and then this is decryption algorithm. If a relation between phi and psi are satisfied, then this ciphertext can be decrypted. Okay, so this is a functional encryption, and this is a security definition of we often call this is a full security of a functional encryption. So then more precisely, full payload hiding security of functional encryption, like this. Firstly, a challenger generates so execute setup and sends a public key system parameter to adversary, and adversary can query, can make a query to a KeyGen Oracle by giving a psi and obtain a secret key with a psi and many times. And also he is allowed to ask a decryption Oracle by with using a psi prime with along with the ciphertext, and then this algorithm executes so firstly inside executes a KeyGen with a psi prime, and then generates a secret key of a psi prime, then executes a decryption algorithm for CT, and then returns a result. And after that, so challenge ciphertext is generated by this. Adversary sends a file and two messages, and then he executes an encryption algorithm and then returns a ciphertext. And then, of course, B is randomly selected, and MB is used in the ciphertext. And then, again, he's allowed to access to a KeyGen Oracle and decryption Oracle, and then finally he gets B prime for B. Then, of course, the advantage is a probability of the B equal B1 minus 1/2. And additionally, we provide we can define an additional security definition attribute hiding. So in a case, it means the ciphertext, ciphertext in a payload, this definition, payload hiding, only the security of this message is constant, but in attribute hiding, the security, some privacy of the both of attribute, the phi and m are constant. So then, Chinese ciphertext is adversary gives a two psi phi 0 and phi 1, and one of them is encrypted, and then adversary we care about the secrecy of the here. So this is attribute hiding. Okay, this is a definition, and this is a brief history of the existing results on the functional encryption. So it's a very special case of functional encryption IDE scheme. The very first in this century, the several results are based on a random Oracle model, and some are secure in the standard model, but security is limited, selective security. So selective security means in a very fast, before the getting the public key, adversary should provide the some information about the challenge. So for example, in the IDBS case, the ID is a given. Or in a case, is a phi, or for example, in a payload hiding case, this phi is a first given, etc. Anyway, so then selective security result obtained in 2004, and then full security of IBE has been obtained in 2005 Waters scheme, and also Gentoo scheme and Waters scheme last year, and the techniques are different. So this uses a some partitioning techniques, and this heavily depend on the some Q type assumptions, and this introduce a new technique, a dual system encryption technique. And this is a very powerful technique, and we will use this technique in our result. And as for attribute-based encryption, inner product encryption, more general functional encryption, so then the first selective security result obtained by Sahan Waters in since 2005, and this year we Reboko, myself, and Sahai Takashima Waters in Eurocrypt presented the first full security result in the functional encryption. It's a one result is a multi access structure attribute-based encryption, and also a inner product attribute hiding inner product encryption. And in this 2 weeks ago, we presented a result in a crypt. It is also a free secure, and but we extend the result from here. It's limited in the monotone case, but we extend to a non-monotone and access structure, more general access structure. And the assumption, both result assumption, non-standard assumptions, are non-standard assumptions, but the result is on a decision reading assumption. Okay. So then, the remaining time of my talk, I will explain the result. It has a summary of the its result. It's so this is a functional encryption with a non-monotone and a general relation for access structures. So what is the general relation? It's a combination of access structure with the inner product. So then it covers both access structure and the inner product relations as a special cases. So it's from a additional linear assumption. And our scheme can be realized by a symmetric or asymmetric pairings, and also we assumed that the prime order groups, not the composite order groups. So usually, many results are based on a composite order group, but as for the efficiency or flexibility, prime order groups are better. So then, okay. And so then, our result is includes previous AB and Hayakawa, some in the product encryption schemes are special cases. So this is a SPAN program. It's often used access structures. And it's a SPAN program is a pair of the matrix, it's a matrix, R times L, L times R. And it's a row is some mapping to a little ones. So each column, each row maps to some rituals. And in if this is a monotone case, only a positive ritual. But in a general non-monotone case, negative positive also can be also mapped. And so then input data is assignment of the each rituals, 0, 1, 0, 0 something. And if the some if this is a for example okay maybe good this example is better to understand. So then in the 6 n equals so then not n it's a l so 1 2 3 4 5 6 it's a so number of columns 6. Then the, oh no, it's not, n is okay. N is the number of literals. Okay? The literal number is six. Then the input is delta is means so P1 is assigned 1, P2 is assigned to 1, P3 is 0, etc. Then now we assume that this row and this row are enough to recover the these two rows, the span of two rows includes all one vector. It means some linear combination of two rows is all one. Then in this case, if P4 is negative, then if P4 is 0, 0 means it's okay, satisfied, and the P2, P2 is 1, and so two, both are satisfied, then and the two rows, span of two rows includes 1, then it is accepted. Okay? This is an example of this time program. And this is combined with secret sharing, and here we select a random vector, F vector, and then S1 is M1 times this vector, S2 is M2, they are share. And then the purpose is to recover S0. S0 is all one times this vector. And then if we apply, for example, in the last case, last slide case, this M2 and M3 spans all one, then the share of S2 and S3 are enough to recover S0 because there are some linear coefficient to recover. It means some same linear coefficient is used for to recover S0 from S2, S3. Okay. And so then this type of a structure is, this access structure is used for attribute-based encryption. And so then in attribute-based encryption, the each ritual is a truth value of the attribute is equivalent or not. So M and the access structure, M and row maps to some ritual. And ritual is correspond to a vector V, some attribute. And then input is expressed by the, for example, here is a X vector. And then check whether the X1 is a V1, X2 is a, etc. Then if equivalent, then this row is satisfied. And then, for example, M2 and M3 are satisfied. X1, V1, V2, X2 is equivalent. And V3, X3 and V3 is equivalent. Then they are satisfied. Then after that, some secret share embedded in the encryption, the recover, then encryption ciphertext is decrypted by such a decryption key. This is a rough idea of the application of access structure to the attribute-based encryption. And so in the result, we extend such a, okay, yeah. So in the previous attribute-based encryption is based on equality for the two, so equality is combined with access structure. But in our approach, each some this map maps to not just attribute but a vector. This is a vector Boolean. This is a vector but also, and we introduce a negative case. And this type of some kind of combination of access structure and the inner product property implemented in our scheme. So then, in this case, the gamma is a input for access this this structure. And the for example, this is a access structure with inner product, and this side is a ciphertext, for example, gamma side. And Four means this is some parameter of the vector, and if four is equivalent and x two v two and v four, maybe it's a misprint. Okay, v four and v two is not zero, and two is two here, v three and x two, v three and x three as a zero, then it is a satisfied. It means the inner product is zero, and then not is means the inner product is non-zero. So then this input satisfies this structure. Then in this case, and if M2 and M3 span this one, then this structure can satisfy this one. Okay. And we introduce this type of a combination of inner product with an access structure for a scheme. And so then our scheme is such a general relation. So then our result, our scheme includes these schemes, KP and CP attribute-based encryption with non-monotone access structure with equal relations. So then as a special case, so here is a vector, the two-dimensional vector, and we also include the zero and non-zero inner product encryption scheme as a special case, and zero inner product encryption scheme is also has a attribute hiding property. Okay, this is a and we also provides a hierarchical scheme. Okay, so then what is the key techniques of a result? Is first one is dual system encryption methodology by introduced by Waters last year to prove the security, full security, and also we use our framework dual pairing vector spaces that I mentioned before the break, and also we introduce a new technique to prove security hierarchical design and security proofs. Okay, so then this technique is like this. So then our scheme is constructed of dual pairing vector spaces. So maybe you can recognize that this is a kind of a more higher level concept than just a pairing groups. So then such a higher level of concept easier for us to design highly functional systems. But we want to improve the security of some primitive level assumption like a DD assumption. So then we have to some fill the gap between the higher level concept and the lower level primitive assumptions. So then we introduce new techniques to prove the security of a higher level design policy from a primitive level assumptions. Okay. So here again I introduce, explain additional linear assumptions. So previously I introduced a bit of general S decision linear assumption, but here is just some simple decision linear assumption like this. The element is G, G1, G2 are given, and omega, gamma, psi are randomly selected, and the problem is to distinguish V and U. So V is, this part is omega plus gamma, omega is, omega gamma is random scalar values, and U is a random element. So then this is a DD assumption. Okay. And okay, so then to explain, so to, you know, before to explain our functional encryption scheme, I will give some hint by explaining the simpler scheme. It's an inner product encryption scheme. So this is like this. This scheme is a first step is a setup, and so then this is the same notation that I used before break. DPVS B and A B star n plus two dimensional vector spaces from pairing groups. And the public key is B space, a secret key is B star, this is B, and secret key is B star. And encryption of inner product is like this. The parameter is a vector V, and so then given vector V, the encryption process is very simple, just a linear combination over these spaces. So then it means that sigma is just a random value, and so V1 times V1 star Vn, Vn star plus Vn plus 1 star. So then we often use this type of notation. This is a sigma V vector 1, 0 vector over B star basis, okay, like this. So then it's a very simple. Given V star, the encryption is like this. Just this vector over B star basis. And this is a parameter of the encryption is an X vector. This is also very simple. It's just this vector form of a public parameter B basis. Okay? And then this is C1. C2 is some theta is some random value. And it's an L-gamma part. So then decryption is also very simple. So just inner product of this and this is pairing operation of this and this is okay. Did you say inner product? Okay, pairing is pairing of K star and C1 is GD to the inner product. Okay, so then inner product is like this. It's now if XV, X times X and V are orthogonal, then this inner product is zero. Then theta is recovered, okay? This and this and this. So then, okay, so then if this satisfied, GT to this part, this value is calculated just by using a pairing. Pairing is enough to recover. But if this is non-zero, this is perfectly random because this sigma is independently randomly selected. So then such a value, and omega is also, omega sigma is independently random from others. Then if it is a non-zero, it is a perfectly random. Okay? Then M prime is recovered if and only if this is satisfied. Okay? Well, this is very, very simple construction. And but this, unfortunately, it is not a proven secure under standard assumption. It is a proven secure in a generic model, but not satisfactory. So then this is an adaptive secure scheme over in a standard model over dealing assumption. Okay? So the difference, it is also very, very simple. The difference is the space is expanded from in a previous case, the space dimension is just so vector is n-dimensional, then the space for encryption and decryption is n plus 2, almost the same, but in the scheme, the dimension of space is 3N plus 2. So then expand it around 3 times. And this type, in a scheme, this part is ozone, and this part is random. And in encryption, this part is ozone, and this part is also, but this part is this part is random. Okay, so this is the adaptive secure, some provable secure in the standard model by introducing the additional space to around the 2N dimension is added to the system. And such a space is essentially used in, to prove the security. Okay, I will explain how to use such a space to prove the security, but now I will also briefly introduce a more general functional encryption scheme. The scheme is a bit more complicated than the inner product encryption, but the key setup procedure, okay, before setup, it's a kind of setup procedure. In the setup procedure, we generate parameters, etc. And then, anyway, it's a very similar to the previous case and but here we prepare the D spaces. In a previous case, in the inner product, only some higher dimensional ones, V and V star, but here there are D spaces. And okay, then there is a setup procedure. Firstly, we generate basis BT, B and B star for each D plus 1 spaces, T equals 0 to D. And the first space, T equals 0 in the case, 0, then the dimension is a five dimensional. And other T equals 1 to D, depending on some setting, in some it's some pre-setting for which dimension is required. Anyway, so then the size of the space is depending on the pre-setting. And then secret key is this value, but not everything. Some part is dropped. And especially, and also, public key is also not every B, but some value is dropped. Okay, such a dropping some bases, base is very essentially important in a security proof. Okay, anyway, so then this is a case of a CP cyphertext policy functional encryption, and input is the ciphertext policy. Policy is a parameter for a ciphertext. So then this is a policy of a case. And it's a key gen. It's a secret key generation. So there is no policy. It's just an attribute. It's attribute vector. So then for each T, we set the attribute is given by gamma. So then T equal 1, from T equal 1 to D, attribute vector is given. Then secret key is like this form for each T. But this is almost same as a case of inner product encryption. So this vector is M, this part, and this is 0, and this is a random part. Okay, like this. So for T equals 0, this is a five-dimensional, this type of key is generated. And for each T, this form, and this form, and this form, depending on the size. But this form is almost same as inner product case. Okay. And the more complicated is for encryption for the key policy, semantics policy. So then this policy is a parameter for encryption. And then the policy is expressed by the access structure M and Rho, and Rho is expressed by the this form and mapped to a vector. And so there are two cases, a positive case and negative case, and the different form of a positive case and negative case. Then we implement this information to a access structure. And as I mentioned, that this is a matrix of M and Rho, and so then this vector we are it's corresponding to these values as by this map. And then secret share is applied. Then this is our scheme, cyphertext policy encryption. So then to apply a secret share, firstly we generate shares and then correspond to each row of the matrix, and then so then the share is correspond to each row, and then each row has some map row, and if this is mapped to a positive and this is a negative, then depending on the cyphertext is different depending on this form. Anyway, so this is also, each one is fairly simple, almost similarly simple as in the product case, like this. Okay, then this is okay, and this form, okay. And this is decryption. And decryption uses some access structure property with secret sharing, then it is fairly simple. So I omit the explanation of the decryption mechanism. But anyway, decryption process is can be by this equation. Okay. And okay, and we can show the the scheme is like this. The scheme is adaptively payload hiding against chosen plaintext attacks under the dealing assumption. Okay, then to transform this scheme to a free secure. Free secure means security against chosen cyphertext attacks. It is we have a very standard way of conversion from such a CCA, a CPA, CPA scheme to a CCA scheme by using a connected hybrid cards conversion or body cards conversion. Then the part is a very easy part. Then this part is a most difficult part. Anyway, so then we can achieve adaptive security from a dealing assumption. Okay, the I roughly explain the strategy of to how to prove the adaptive security in the scheme. And for simplicity, I will explain the strategy by the very simple case is the inner product encryption case. Okay, so you know, in the inner product encryption, the adversary can ask keygen query, secret keygen generation query with sending vectors. So for example, adversary sends a V1 vector to the challenger simulator. And then simulator challenger generates a secret key with V1 and gives a secret key to adversary. And adversary gives many questions to keygen oracles. And then sometimes he also provides vector X for a challenge ciphertext to a challenger. And then the condition that the vector should be not orthogonal to these vectors. Okay. This is and finally adversary gets beta. So adversary got a challenge cipher text, and adversary gets adversary of course provides a M0 and M1, which lines are encrypted in the challenge cipher text. So this is a security game in adaptive security game of the inner product encryption. And to prove the security, so it's a game zero. First game is such a kind of a game. And we apply a game transformation to this type of game. In the first transformation is change this one. The challenge cipher text is change to some ill-formed cipher text. So we call the semi-functional form of a cipher text. I'll explain now how the difference of the well-formed and ill-formed. Anyway, so then the next game transformation, we will change the first key query key is changed from a well-formed normal form to a ill-formed semi-functional form, and then change again gradually. So game 0 and game 1, game 2, da da da. So gradually changing again, again, again. And finally, every cipher text and the secret keys ill-formed in the very last game. Then in the very last game, the information theoretically advantageous adversary is 0. Okay, if we show that the difference, the advantage difference with each transformation is negligible, then we can complete the proof. Okay, this is a very rough strategy of security proof. And finally, the well-formed and ill-formed. So then we call the normal cipher text as a well-formed, and the normal form is a. Okay, then the final is a semi-functional form. It's a. So then, as I mentioned that in some scheme description, this part is all zero, and this part is all zero. But in a semi-functional ciphertext, this form is changed. It's a kind of random values. And but if, for example, if we apply a pairing with a this ciphertext and this normal key, then if we apply an inner product, then this part is also, even if this part is randomized, this part can be cancelled by also. Then the application of if we decrypt the normal key for a semi-functional ciphertext, then we can decrypt correctly. Okay? And we also change from one form of semi-functional and a key. Okay. Here's the problem. If we change this part randomly, and this is already random, then if we apply this key to this ciphertext, then the result should be random. So, but in a game transformation, we use a very special random value for two positions, and these orange parts are some correlated, not just a random, but some correlated, such that. So simulator, the correlation is very well some works. So then the simulator use this form and this form to simulate the game transformation. So then the simulator cannot distinguish for if he, there are two cases, the semi-functional normal case, and also semi-functional and semi-functional. But if, in this case, the simulator knows that this ciphertext can be correctly decrypted. But even if this cipher, this key is changed to this one, but if these parts are so carefully correlated, then again, Shibueta cannot distinguish this case because in this case, this ciphertext can be correctly decrypted by even for a simulator because it's carefully correlated for the if it means if x vector and v vector are orthogonal, then at the time this two values also looks a similar property of the this case. Okay, and but for the adversary view. Adversary, query for the adversary is limited. So then, for example, x vector cannot be orthogonal to a v vector. In that case, these values are correlated, but for the adversary view, in the case of the x vector and v vector are not orthogonal, then these values are perfectly information theoretically random. Okay, so then, in the case is x vector and v vector orthogonal, then this is this works like a normal case. But x vector and v vector are not orthogonal; they are information theoretically random. Okay, so by using such a correlation between the two values, then we can prove that the game transformation from a normal to a semi-functional is very guaranteed to be a normal under the linear assumption. Okay, so this is a very rough strategy in a security proof. Maybe I will spend my time. Okay, so then it's a very last two slides. So then, Anyway, so our scheme is based on constructed, designed over the higher level of concept of dual pairing vector space, not just from the primitive level of the pairing vector pairing groups. So then, you know, such a concept is very helpful for us to design more complicated schemes. Okay, but to improve security, you know, from the so then to improve security, you know, just I mentioned that in the very strategy. Then still we can either better useful, helpful for us to use a high level assumption. It's an assumption over DPVS. But so then such assumption, higher level assumption is very useful, very helpful for describe some security proof. The gap is very negligible. But we want to prove such a security under a linear assumption, not such a higher level assumption. Then to do, we introduce a higher level sum reduction, hierarchical reduction from a top lower level. So then this is structure of a security proof. So then we introduce a game transformation for, so then This description is a higher level of a concept of DPVS, and this level of assumption of DPVS. But middle is still DPVS, but gradually simple, and then the bottom level of assumption is pairing groups. And then we reduce to the finally dealing from the top, and then total security is reduced to a DD assumption in a security group. Okay. So this is we introduce a two way of a modular way of proof. The game transformation is a very nice way to make a security proof in a modular way. And we also introduce another way of a modular way of a security proof. So horizontal and direct and some this way. Okay. So I'm sorry, I spent the time. Thank you very much for your attention.